Okay, let's start from there. Before I start, as I said last evening, I must confess, I have no special qualification to talk on this subject. And therefore, being a student of this science, like many of you, I know just a little bit of it. I know as much as I've studied, no more. But this is a big limitation on me, so don't expect the answers which you would expect from an expert, because I'm no expert. But since I am a student and you are also students, we could share some thoughts. When we think of positive thought and positive thinking as a means to beat the mind with, it's just like saying using a dog's tail to beat the dog. Here we are trying to deal with the substance of thought, that is the mind. That seems to give rise to problems. And we say we are going to use that very mind to beat the mind. Just like holding a dog's tail to try to beat a dog, you just can't do it. I have not come across anyone who has been able to use the mind to either subdue the mind or to tackle the mind in a way that it becomes useful to us. The mind is useful in many ways. Thought is useful in its own way. But if thought is an obstacle to what you're trying to do, and if the mind comes in the way of what you're trying to do, you can't use the mind
to correct the imbalance or to remove the obstacle, the mind itself is raising. Therefore, whether you call it positive thinking or you call it negative thinking, it doesn't help. Thinking doesn't help in that situation. The best thinking can do in such a situation is, if your thinking is good, if your thinking is developed enough, and if your thinking can go all the way out to examine all the possibilities that thought can provide, the best thinking can do is to say, I can do this much and no more. And what you are trying to do, which is to remove the obstacles of thought, is beyond me. That thought should be able to suggest this much is the best contribution that thought can do. It has been recognized for a long time that intellect operates under certain conditions, which conditions are themselves an obstacle to realization. And therefore, the best intellect can do, and the best contribution intellect can make to our understanding and realization is to say, I can do no more than that. If the intellect can discover its own limitations, it has done a good job. And I guess thoughts, which are the manifest form, can make the best contribution by saying, thought can go this much and no further. Now let's see how far thoughts can go, whether they're negative or positive. All thoughts must take place within the laws time and space and causation. There are no thoughts which can occur without time, space and causation. All thoughts take that form. The thinking mechanism requires these conditions. It is a necessary precondition for thinking. And when we are trying to analyze the very nature of time, when we are trying to transcend time as it were, when we are trying to understand concepts like timelessness, then thought by its very nature and definition not only becomes an obstacle, but defines the area where it must stop and something else must take over. Now, it's here that the question arises that if thought cannot go beyond what is within the domain of time, space, and causation, what is it that can take us beyond that? It must be something. A lot of people talk of realization all the time. People talk of meditation, in which in a moment they have got a grasp of things which they couldn't get in time for a long period with intellectual understanding and logic. We call it by different words. The two most popular words used are love and intuition. I said last evening that these are two functions of the soul. And you can have both love and intuition, experience of love and experience of intuition without invoking the laws of time, space or causation. You can have this experience even here. You can have love for somebody, for another person here. And in that instant of love, when that particular instant takes place, when you realize you are in love, no time has been used. There is no time for the experience of love. There is time required for thinking over the love. There is time required for any events we connect with love. But for love itself, no time is required. Similarly, for pure intuition, spiritual intuition, which we call intuition of the soul, no time is required. We say, just in a flash, this thing came to me. And that flash seems to constitute the area where intuition works. And that flash does not have any time. So we know that there are functions which our consciousness is performing, which do not need these laws of time, space, and causation. I might at this stage add that although I say time, space, causation, these are standard terms, therefore I'm using them. Otherwise, it would suffice if I said time. Because time includes space and also includes causation. If you were to have time, you have to have the beginning, the middle, and the end. You have to have the past, the present, and the future. And therefore, when you talk of time, you automatically create conditions for space and for causation. Now, what is space? Space is another word for time. When Einstein described time as a dimension of space, he started from space, therefore he had to go back to the fourth dimension. But if you start from time and use that as the main dimension, you find that space is merely an extension of time. I'll give you a small illustration to bring this point, make this point a little clear. We have talked of the stars in the heavens, which are out in space. And the nearest star seems to be one light year away. And some of the furthest ones, the quasars and others, which we have recently discovered and seen through giant electronic telescopes, seem to be several billion years, a billion light years away. Now, when we talk of a star that is a billion light years away, and we have seen now, we are not talking of the star that is there now out in space. We are talking of a star that was there a billion years ago. If we talk of a star which is one light year away, which is the nearest to us, incidentally, out in space, outside of our planetary system, solar system. If we talk of a star which is one light year away, we are talking of the star that was there 1 year ago. It is not that we know what is there now. To know what is there now, we have to wait for another year. In other words, when we use long space, when we use the terminology for very large areas of space, then we begin to find that we do no more than use the same terminology, the same measurement as we use for time. We use 1 year ago for time, and we use one light year ago for a star. That means that the depth of space seems to be incapable of perception by us, except after the elapsing of certain time, because it has been established that nothing can travel at a velocity greater than the velocity of light. That being so, this puts a limitation on how far we can have present knowledge of things out in space. Since nothing can travel at a velocity higher than the velocity of light, we can see nothing a little further away from us at this time, at this moment. Whatever we will see will be in the past. Because we can't see immediately, it must take time to come to us. Therefore, all that we see has taken place in the past. What is happening right now, we have to wait for more time to pass before we can see it. In other words, there is no difference in long space and in long time. Both are the same. Now, this is merely to illustrate the point. In fact, the same thing would apply even to short space and short time. When I look at you or you are looking at me, there's a time lag between your seeing me and my being where I am. So whenever you are seeing me a little later because of the time lag, because of perceptive processes. The perceptive process may be through the fastest means of transmission, which is light, or by the slower means of audition and hearing and touch and so on, which is slower, which take more time for the perceptive process to pick up. Therefore, there is a time lag between what we call the visual perception and the actual occurrence which we are perceiving. And that time lag is exactly proportionate to what we call the depth in space. Therefore, the degree of time that has elapsed is directly proportionate and related to the degree of depth in space. Therefore, it is no different to say that is very far away in time or to say it is very far away in space. That is why space is an extension of time. But why does it look different to us in our everyday experience? If it were the same thing, it should look the same. It looks different because we have ourselves split our perceptive faculties into different compartments, seeing, hearing, touching, smelling, so on. Having divided perception into compartments, we don't have total perception of anything. We have divided perception. And this divided perception seems to give us a multi-dimensional perception of various things that are happening, various events that are taking place. And it's for this reason that we begin to say that so far away, and yet it has passed so long ago. We talk of long ago and far away because we use different divided faculties of perception. Actually, they are the same thing. There's no difference. And we could, in a way, if we understood time a little better, that means if we understood time a little more than the intellect enables us to understand, whether it's positive thinking or not, any kind of thinking, if we could understand time beyond the understanding given to us by thinking or by intellect, then we would know that perception is not dependent upon this split faculties of sense perception, but that you could perceive without having to split it into different senses. And at that stage, you would realize that space, all types, is merely an extension of time. That the laws of causation, which arise from there being a beginning and an end, and a middle, which are arising because of the process of time in the way in which we know it now, namely, a unidirectional, single space time, where it's moving according to the ticking of the clock. This kind of time creates a setup in which we perceive only through this law of causation. Something happening first, something happening later. Imagine if this time were pulled out of that, there would be neither cause nor effect, because they would be simultaneous. And I tell you, this business of cause and effect is creating so many problems for us. I'll name one of them for your consideration. We say, we are looking at it. How do we look at it? Here is a glass of water. I'm looking at the glass of water. How do I look? Well, the answer is simple. That the ray, this light falls on it. If I put up all the lights, I don't see. Therefore, there's something in the light. When the light falls on this, something, some part of the light is going to drop, the rest of it is reflected. That comes up in all, almost parallel lines and goes into the eye through the lens, forms an inverted image on the retina. The retina holds the rods, they pick them up through the optic nerve, take them to the brain center, right place. And the brain then creates the right kind of vibration, which is picked up by consciousness. So if you are unconscious and the whole thing is operating, we don't see. Even if we are unconscious by a hit on the head, or we are unconscious by ether, we can have our eyes open, have us look at it, put the light on, we don't see. But if we are conscious, we see. Therefore, we say, this glass of water is the cause, and my seeing of it is the effect. There has been no proof offered yet that that is not the cause, and this is the effect. I put it to you that it's the other way around. In fact, it is the other way around. That because your power of consciousness has the capacity to project, therefore you are in a position to form the same kind of impulses in the optic nerve. Therefore, you are in a position to form an inverted image of this glass on the retina. Therefore, you are able to project that into this glass. In any case, you will see it the same way. Supposing this glass were not there, but the human retina had a built-in capacity to develop an inverted image of various kinds. Let us assume, only for the sake of argument, that the human retina had the capacity to form images at will, depending upon a certain process which I will discuss now. Then, if such an image were formed of the human retina, in the manner it is now being formed, I would see the glass exactly as I am seeing now. There would be no difference whatsoever. Same thing would apply to all other senses of perception, whether it is touch or hearing or any other sense. Because all the senses operate the same way. Through our nervous system, they pick up these impulses, they carry them, and because we believe in this unidirectional business of time and in the business of cause and effect, therefore, we have begun to believe that this world we live in, all things of matter that we live around us are the cause. And our perception of them is the effect. What is the result? We make ourselves a very small speck in a huge big world which has been going on for billions of years. And all this cosmos is real and has been there. And we are merely small speck taking part in perceiving this or that part of it. Now I suggest to you, take the other way around. That this capacity to create the glass or anything else is dependent upon the nervous system. or the eye or the other system of perception. And that such things can happen there. We will see these things and the whole world exactly as we are seeing them. In case this the physical system did not have that power, but only the brain cells could develop that, even then we would see the world exactly as it is, because the rest of the functions are exactly the same. Supposing even the brain cells had none of that power, only consciousness, only human consciousness, which makes us awake, which makes us understand each other, talk to each other. If only human consciousness were there, we would still see the glass exactly as we are seeing now. And no one has understood what human consciousness is and how it is operating. We have spent a lot of time studying the glass. We spent a lot of time studying the body. We spent a lot of time studying the brain. We have spent very little time, precious little time, studying what is consciousness. One of our ministers once got involved in an accident some years ago in India. And he became unconscious. He was unconscious for 105 days. He didn't know a thing what was going on. So all kinds of doctors were called in. Since he was an important person, doctors were called in from all over the world. Some of the best, the most modern brain surgeons were called in. I remember one was called in from Montreal, somewhere in Canada, who was supposed to be the best in the field. And he brought a number of experts. And then when he came there, the chief minister of the state where this happened, with whom I was working as a civil servant, he and I, we went and questioned the doctor. And we said, "Doctor, we want to know what makes a man conscious. You are an expert in this." He said, "I have opened up thousands of doors. But this is, sir, a question that has not yet been answered." And philosophers and medical men, religious men, experts in all fields have been trying to find an answer. We have not found an answer. In fact, we cannot even say which part of the brain really holds consciousness. We assume there is some evidence, clinical evidence, to say it is the central part that goes down the spine. That part, we are not sure. And certainly we are not sure what constitutes consciousness. This is the state of affairs. This is how much we know of consciousness. And it is that consciousness alone which gives rise to the experience of a glass. And merely because of this business of causation, law of cause and effect, we take this as real, and that is real. I put it to you that those who have done a little work as students of consciousness, those who have decided not to spend too much time on this, but to spend some time on this, they've gone into the basis of consciousness. They've gone inside the mechanics of consciousness. They have seen that the power to project a glass lies in consciousness. That what we call perception of a glass is a projection of a glass. That what we call as the coming into being of a whole world, as the creation of a world, is not a physical world which we can see, but a world which we can project, and therefore we see. It is not that a world exists outside, which we perceive and we can catch inside, and therefore have experience. It's a world that exists in consciousness, which we can project outwards, and therefore see and feel as we do. That's right. That's quite right. This is exactly the point I'm making. All I'm saying is that here is a point, an instance. I am seeing a glass. I am assuming because of this law of causation that this is real, and my seeing of it is transitory and depends upon the glass being there. This causal direction has never been established. Even in time, nobody has been able to prove, even in time, that this occurs first and the experience of the glass in consciousness occurs later. Even that has not been proved. It is simultaneous. The seeing of the glass in consciousness and the glass here are simultaneous, with no time lag at all, not even the time lag that we ascribe to space. With this situation, where is the proof that this glass exists by itself, and merely because we see it, therefore we are seeing it? I say because we are seeing it, therefore the glass exists. Now, this was so, it's so basic. It's so basic, it would throw an insight into the laws of consciousness and how it operates. And therefore, when we are trying to understand these things, which are the very basis of creation, it helps us a lot. We talk of the word creating everything. I mentioned briefly yesterday. How can the word create everything? How can the word turn into matter and all that? What is meant is very simple. That the word being the inner, inmost core of consciousness, from there it can project a world and thereby become conscious of it. Becoming conscious of a world which looks to be outside is the same thing as creating a world outside. And when you create it with certain well-hidden principles, that world looks as real as if it exists in spite of yourself. Now, if you were to follow this logic and accept it for the sake of argument, that in fact the whole world lies all tied up in consciousness, and from there we project it at different levels. All these things become clear. What are the various stages of ascent? What are the levels of consciousness? What is realization? What is being one with God? How there can be only one consciousness? How everything else is just a projection of one? How there has never been more than one? How there's only one soul? All these so-called things which create dilemmas and problems for us become solved. This one concept, which thought cannot understand, which thought by its very limitation of acting in causation cannot grasp fully, which our spirit can. Even while I'm talking to you, you'll notice there's something that's trying to get in. And yet, there's something that's trying to hold it. How can it be? And you'll notice that the thought process in time is trying to hold it back. There's something else which is trying to grasp. You can have direct experience of the function of intuition and love or identification and the function of thought right now. Here is an experience which you can see and thereby discriminate between your own powers of analytical thinking and the powers of direct perception. They are functioning all the time. Therefore, I say that if this point were to be grasped, that the whole thing is come into being, what we see around us, because of the powers in consciousness, it will answer most of the questions. It's a difficult point to grasp. Thought does not enable us to understand it fully. But if it is understood, it answers many questions. One of the things that follows from this concept is that consciousness is the all-powerful thing. It holds everything. And this whole world, the whole cosmos, its entire billions of years, its depth of space and depth of time, all is just one flash of creation. Instead of becoming a small speck in a big wide world, you have just one flash of the world in a big, huge, powerful consciousness, which is the truth of it. When this awareness comes, not merely by trying to scrape this by intellect, when this awareness comes by shedding covers which force us to act in time, the body, the sense perception, and even the causal body or the mind, then we shake these covers off which force us to think and consider of all these things in terms of time, then we realize, this was the consciousness that gave rise to everything. We realize what the soul is. And when we realize the totality of that consciousness, we realize what God is. This is called God realization. God realization is no more than the uncovering of total consciousness, the single total consciousness that alone is operating and has always operated. There has been none else, ever. Nor will there ever be. So to discover total consciousness, that is God realization, that is realization of the self. And all that we talk of meditation and various techniques of discovery of the self, they are all directed towards the self. How to uncover those obstacles in our way of discovering the reality of consciousness? Because if you knew what is consciousness, you would know everything that is around consciousness. Because what it is conscious of is arising because of consciousness. That is why I would come back to that question and say that there is a very limited role for students of this science that positive thinking can play. Positive thinking can guide us towards a conduct of life. It can direct us towards the limitations with which we are encountering the limitations that are around us. But it cannot help us to overcome those very obstacles which arise because of thought, whether positive or negative. Yes, sir. That is true. We are giving far more importance to intellectual development than we are to development of the spirit or the spiritual intuition. You can do it unofficially. Why do you want to do it officially? How does it? So long as we do it. What are we doing here, sitting together? We are doing precisely that. But you will be surprised. I have talked not to millions, but certainly to thousands. And I have found that all the thousands are not interested in that. It's no use trying to give the kind of education which they don't want. Supposing you and I are convinced that medical education is the best. We can't make all doctors. We can't make everybody MD, even if we want to. Therefore, there has to be certain aptitude. And people have aptitudes. And with those aptitudes, they take one field or the other. Now, those who have aptitude for this field, they will certainly take it, whether you make it official or unofficial. It used to be. You see, the difficulty with traditions is that the traditions last for a while, and later on, they are made into some kind of a doctrinaire, either religion, or a school, or a denominational group, or something. And then most of that tradition is again handled by those who are specialists in the use of intellect. Many of the traditions, which are based upon a rejection of the finer use of intellect, they reject that for those ultimate utilization, intellect can play any part. They rely upon intuition. But when those who have used intuition are no longer there in the group, the others who come in use their intellect to interpret those who use intuition. That's happening all the time. It becomes very difficult. You cannot institutionalize these things. Yes, that is true. It has happened all over. It has happened all over that those who emphasized the use of intuition. And here I must say, there's a little bit of warning that ought to be given about the use of the word intuition. I have used the word intuition in the sense of spiritual intuition, not intellectual intuition. But there is a mental intuition also, which functions in causation. I'm not referring to that. That mental intuition is merely the function of the mind in doing more quickly what normally it would do in a longer time. Sometimes you see that the mind will take a lot of time to add up various things and then come to the conclusion. And then suddenly, in very quickly, it can come to those conclusions, jump over some steps and quickly come to it, which is loosely referred to as mental intuition. I'm not referring to that. I don't. I haven't studied psychology much. Yeah, your question answers itself. When you say mind-blowing drug, it couldn't be expanding intuition. Yes, because if you want me to say something about drugs and its mind-expanding qualities, I could say it. First of all, I might say that when drugs expand the mind, it is a mind as it is located in the physical system. The mind is not an isolated thing functioning by itself. The mind is directly attached to all the other systems. If the mind is functioning through senses, then we call it the sense mind. Because it is not operating by itself, it is operating through the cover of the senses. When the mind is operating through the cover of the senses and also the cover of the physical body, we call it the physical mind. Because that mind is not free to do what it would do if it were not so covered. Therefore, when a mind is covered by the sense perceptions and also by the physical system, it operates differently. These drugs you referred to operate only on the physical mind, which means they give rise to extraordinary experiences, unnatural experiences, rare experiences, experiences which have some kind of a reflection of experiences that would arise in a mind that is not so tied down, but they are all physical experiences. And the manner of verifying that they are physical experiences is very simple. Here we are having an experience right now. To tell you the truth, people say, Ishwar, have you seen a miracle? And I say that I am seeing you is the greatest miracle. It's a fact that we can see, that we can have experience of this world as we are having. It's the greatest miracle. We don't call it a miracle because now we have started using the definition that what is different from what we are seeing must be a miracle. We don't realize that the very powers that create the so-called extraordinary experience, whether it's by taking of a drug or by a yogic concentration in one of the centers in the physical system, any one of the six centers in the physical system, or by any other power of suggestion, to be able to see these extraordinary things, which in their nature are no different, perhaps worse, than the kind of things we see in living, wakeful world. They are all physical reactions, and there is no business to call them miracles or extraordinary visions or astral experiences when they are not making you more awake than you are now. The criterion is, are you more awake than you are now? Not that you are having a different experience. However novel and strange the experience might be, they are not making you more awake. On the other hand, if you can raise your level of consciousness by means of true meditation and the correct meditation, you will find at every step you are more awake than you ever were before. And each lower level of consciousness to you gives the experience like waking from a dream. When you wake up from a dream, you don't question, am I awake or not? You know you are in a higher level of consciousness. You know that was a dream. You have certainty of knowledge in the change of level of consciousness. It should be that kind of change. And meditation enables us to change levels of consciousness towards more and more wakeful states, just like waking up from a dream. And there is no doubt left. You don't need verification. You don't even pinch yourself to see you are awake. It's just like that. You don't need anybody's proof. Am I awake? Because you are awake. And there is direct knowledge of the state in which you are. On the other hand, all these so-called mind-expanding drugs, all these so-called consciousness-expanding practices which are being used, are being used in conjunction with the physical mind, in conjunction with physical awareness. They are being used in conjunction with awareness as we relate it to our physical body. And therefore, however strange they may be, however much they may expand our area of vision, it's still physical. They have not made you more awake. And here, as students of the science of which we are students sitting here, we are not interested merely in having new vision, because we can see plenty of them. We are interested in waking up, in knowing what is the reality, what in fact causes all these visions, what in fact causes all that we can experience. We are trying to find the real cause, not merely the cause of the cause and effect phenomenon. That being the object here, those mind-expanding drugs do not help us at all. I know a lot of people have taken those drugs, have extraordinary experiences, come to me. In fact, I was in Boston, in Harvard University, when the two professors who first worked on it were expelled from that university. I was there in the same year. And I met their group who first started taking acid and had various kinds of experiences. And I met those who had tried all kinds of things, and we compared notes. And when I could talk to them of the experience which they had, they used to catch me and say, now which one did you take? Because they found that whereas they were talking of those experiences which were virtually involuntary for them, which occurred without their control, which did not give them any control over even that experience which they were having, I could talk of those experiences as if I was interpreting a small little theory in a book, as if I was describing exactly what happened to them. So when I told them what was happening to them, they said, how do you know what happened to us? I told them that what you are doing with drug, this turning on can be done without drugs also. It's a physical operation. It's a physical thing that is happening. And these centers here in the physical body, these six centers, which are called the vital centers, they are holding the plexus. They are holding the various vibrations of the physical vital systems to hold the body and the conscious complex together. That is life together. They keep life in this body. And these six centers, they operate as vital links of different flows of energy current. And once you put your attention forcefully with a good, nice little, well-trained beam onto any of these centers, you will get all these experiences. Because you are in fact getting accidental experiences by use of drugs which lower or raise your focal point of consciousness onto those very centers. Just by tickling those centers, you get some of these odd experiences. Why not, if you're so interested in them, get down to them, go and see them, how they operate. Why don't you see them from within? Instead of getting into a trip which will take you into all kinds of experiences outside on the wall, why don't you get into a trip in which you find out how trips are made? Why don't you get to find out the truth of the whole matter? Which interested some of them. They later on became students of this path. But I am only mentioning that here, these drugs give us novel experiences. They cannot expand the true spiritual intuition at all, because they do not come within that range at all. They are not only within the range of, not within the range of true intuition, they are not even in the range of mental intuition. What I said was the mechanics of the mind working out certain things more quickly than it is normally accustomed to do. These drugs even do not enable that. The drugs only enable the mind operating through senses and operating through a physical body, having novel experiences. And these experiences certainly give some kind of a reflected idea of what could be the truth. But then the rest of the experience, physical experience we are having here, meeting each other, seeing a human being talk, seeing a flower grow, the color of this, the color of this leaf, these are giving me equally good reflected images and reflected inspiration of what could be real. If these can give me, why should I seek something else which is slightly different from this to get the inspiration? Therefore, there is no very great use served by taking either these drugs or doing other kinds of physical violence to your system by which you get extraordinary experiences. The best thing is to follow the natural system. What is the natural system? The natural system must operate from where nature has placed you. Now, we know, so long as we are bound by these covers, including the last one, that is the physical body, we just try to contemplate, where are we? Now, when I talk of we, I'm talking of consciousness, by definition. By definition, I said that we are referring to the science of the understanding of consciousness and its processes. That being so, when we are sitting in this body, we should say, where am I? And if we just contemplate, say, I'm not in the hands, I can feel the hands, but I'm not really operating from there. I'm not knowing about my hands by being in the hands. And you close your eyes and you try to see where you are operating from in the body. When you are awake, the answer comes somewhere behind the eyes. You just can't make a mistake. Anyone who tries to contemplate, where is my consciousness operating from? He says, somewhere just behind the eyes. Because when I close, I know if I were pure consciousness, not the body, I would be sitting behind the eyes. That's the feel we get when we are awake. When we are asleep, we don't have that feeling. In fact, if somebody could have the consciousness of the body while dreaming, and he would say, where am I? You see the thought in front of us. And since we can't be aware of the body normally when we are dreaming, therefore, you take the example when you are half asleep, when you're drowsy and falling off asleep, and you haven't really lost consciousness, you are daydreaming, and you know you are falling half asleep and you are half awake, and you're still conscious of the body. You say, where am I? The same question. And you find that the tip of the nose comes in front of you. You can actually see it. Yes, this is where you are. You can feel it anytime. If you could keep up the consciousness of the body while you are falling off asleep, you find that this is going on descending. And as you get into the dream state, you descend it right here. As you get to deep sleep, you descend it right below. This is happening all the time. So we are shifting our focal point of consciousness at various centers. These are the physical centers designed to give rest to the system, designed to provide those kinds of variations in consciousness, which are good for the system. But this does not mean that because of these things happening, therefore these faculties or these centers become the centers of intuition. None of them are the centers of intuition. Our natural center of wakefulness, from which we want to rise further, is here. These are all below us. And as we go below, our level of consciousness, our degree of awareness, our degree of wakefulness becomes less. Yes. Yes. The mind is active. The mind is always doing three things. Always. The mind is sensing, the mind is reasoning, and the mind is creating. I explained yesterday how the mind performs these three functions all the time. The mind is picking up elements of sense perception from the various senses, thereby saying, I know this through senses. The mind is then using these in words, meaningful sounds, which have their own connotations arising from the association of ideas of that particular individual. Uses words to reason them out, which it is doing continuously, without break, without exception, day in and day out. And then the mind is creating. Yes, 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 yes. The mind and soul, sensory system, the whole complex of consciousness. It is operating from a focal point as if it is concentrated at one point from where it projects out. That center shifts. Oh, you are changing the subject into something very different. Sins brings us to ethics. If you like, I'll take that up. I can take that up if you like. What is ethics? Yes. Yes, certainly. Because this is something that I'll have to go over several times again before it is really understood. It's a very, very difficult concept. The concept as stated is not difficult. It's very easy. It becomes difficult when we try to pick it up by intellect. The reason is simple. That the intellect then tries to put it through this, its own method of trying to see how I can make this the cause and that the effect. And then some difficulties arise because we have been brought up from birth into assuming that this is the cause and that's the effect. Now suddenly somebody is reversing the whole process. It takes a little time to absorb something quite new. But the concept is not very difficult to state. It's difficult to absorb. Therefore, I'll go over it again. It is this, that the seeing of a thing is real. I put it a different way now. I'm trying to put it a different way to make my point. I say I'm seeing the glass. The seeing of the glass is real. It is absolutely real. It's as real as God. But the glass is not. Which means that when I see a glass, the seeing of the glass is a real fact. Because I am seeing. There's no question of doubting that. But the inference that my mind is reaching, that because I am seeing the glass is really existing by itself, that is wrong. That means the coming of the glass into being as it is not independent of the process of seeing the glass. My process of seeing, feeling, touching, knowing the glass is all that there is in it. There's no glass beyond that. Exactly. Not the camera. The different film loaded into that projector. Exactly. Therefore, it is the nature of a projector in which a film has been loaded and then that film is projected out in four dimensions. Not the ordinary one on the screen, not even the one where you put the specs and become 3D, but a film that becomes 4D. It's a four-dimensional film which we are watching. It's so real that we take it as real. We have no time to turn back and see where the projector is. We have given no thought to that, no attention. We can give it, there's no problem. I mean, once one wants to do it, there's no problem. One can suddenly turn around and say, let me see, what's there? And one gets the answer. The real answer cannot be given by me here. The real answer can be given by each one of us by turning around and seeing what is there that's causing this projection. And let me see if it is a projection at all or not, or it's merely picking up of a message. So, there, those who have turned around and had a look at the system in which consciousness operates, it's their experience. And we ought to give some consideration that when they say their experience proves conclusively after looking at the function of consciousness, that consciousness alone was capable of projection, like a 4D film, and the film was loaded in there, and not only that, they go further to say why that film was loaded, why that particular film was loaded, why this particular pattern of experience has come into being, which explain by the intricate processes of the impressions the mind is capable of picking up, which we call sanskar or karma. All this law of karma, sanskar, which is used in the scriptures in India, all becomes clear. They are all explained in these terms, that these are impressions which are picked up, and those impressions are then projected out, and they create the world based upon the reaction to those impressions. Then things become very clear. Yes, certainly. They go together. When one finds that all life, so-called life, was part of the projection, then all life becomes that. All living beings are different. While we are saying, well, he is looking at this, he is looking at that, she is doing that, she is doing that, then you find that all of that has come from one self, loaded in the self. Not loaded in I, not loaded in George, but loaded in the self. See, because what is George? This body, which you're wearing. This self is part of the projection. When we are examining the nature of the projection, the nature of the image on the screen, on the wide reader, four-dimensional screen, then we have to take the whole of it together. We can't say, well, this is real, George is here, and the rest of it I'm going to see. You have to see the whole screen together. When you see the whole screen together, then you find that all other bits of consciousness that are around you are arising because of this projection. Therefore, there being one projector, everything is one. It's like a dream again. In the dream, you meet a lot of people. When you go to sleep and dream, you see a lot of people. They not only talk to you, They argue with you, they fight with you, they think differently from you. When you wake up, you know they did not exist. Till you wake up, you know there are many different consciousnesses. You see, there are many bits of life. They're all different. While the dream lasts, they're all different. When you wake up, you suddenly discover that although they look so different, they behave so different, you could never imagine that they were part of yourself. They were in fact part of yourself. But they were part of your mind. In the same way, if this mechanics of meditation could help us to awaken further from this big, much better dream, we would find that all these things we saw, all other bits of life we saw, were dream creatures, therefore projections of you. There was one dreamer alone. And all the way up, right to this totality of consciousness, which we call God. God realization means becoming God. To have totality of consciousness means being totality of consciousness. When you are that, you discover there was always only one totality of consciousness. It has never been split at no time. The dreamer has dreamt many dreams and thereby created creation. But there has been not more than one creator at all, including the so-called self, who is a human being. There has always been one. Once you understand this mechanics of creation through consciousness, all the doubts which we come across by reading these books are resolved. Everything falls into place and the answers are provided to us. Intellectual questions include. But this is a difficult concept to understand because we have been brought up to this age with a different concept. That's what it means. You understand this concept that I have explained, it will explain all the terminology used in any of the books. I have not come across any contradiction between any two books, any two philosophers, any two mystics, once this concept is understood. They all fall into place. Yes, sir. That's right. Now, what's the question? What are the difficulties? If you tell me the difficulties, I could... Yes. No, you mean to say I should tell you my difficulty? You know, the method is very simple. Our technique of meditation is extremely simple. It is so simple that sometimes people don't accept it because it is too simple. The technique is that we have gone about this business of creation through consciousness by various factors of impressions on various levels of mind that have given rise to this whole big world around us, which we are now taking as real. And we are involved in the so-called stories that come into being because of this creation. What holds us to this world is not the mechanics of this world, not the mechanics of projection, but the human story that we built into this projection. I'll try to explain this a little more because this is crucial to our understanding of the method. When we read a book, an interesting story book, and we read it page by page, as the story goes on, we are involved in the story and not in the pages, the printing, and the binding of the book. As the story unfolds and the critical moments come, and we say, what next? And we are all full of it. We are not at that time concerned that what next is already printed in the book. We think it's going to develop now. As we read, we think that the story is going forward now. We are involved in the story, not in the mechanics of the book. And therefore, we read page by page. Otherwise, there was nothing to prevent us from reading the last page first. But because of our involvement in the story, we read page by page, page by page, even forgetting that the whole story is already there in our hand. And we think that the story is developing. Now what will happen to this guy? Now what's going to happen to this one? And all these questions involve us, identify us with the story in that book. And it goes on and on. It's a very similar situation for us here. The whole film has been loaded. The whole book is there with us in our consciousness. We are reading the story page by page. We are not interested at all in the mechanics of projection. We are interested in the story. That's so and so. That's my wife. That's my child, that's my father, that's my friend. He hurt me, he loved me, he did this. It's the story that binds us. We have gone out so much into these events emotional, spiritual, mental, into these events that hold us together. We have no time to get off from them and see how is it coming up at all. So much so that we have forgotten that we were supposed to watch the story. We have become participants in the story. And very good participants. We do not differentiate between ourselves, even the real self, and the characters of the story. Yes, but it is a self-imposed illusion because we enjoy it. We like it that way. It's a good part of the story. If that were not there, the story wouldn't be that interesting. You'll see that all the elements of the story which make it look real are the essential elements of the story. It wouldn't be sufficiently good. Now, after all, we call it a play. Call it, instead of calling it a story, I call it a play. It's a huge, big play going on, in which we are all acting. Who is the audience for this play? The audience is naturally the totality of ourselves. Nobody else is watching the play. We are in the play, we are watching the play. We might say, the totality of consciousness is the audience of this play. Totality of consciousness means God. God is the audience for this play. You think God could have a poor play put up? We go to see a play in Broadway or off Broadway, in New York recently. We go to a play and we think that play is good, in which the actors live real parts. They act so really that they forget their actors. And that's the real good play. And the more sophisticated the audience, the more live parts, the more real acting they must do. And if the audience is as sophisticated as totality of consciousness itself, as God himself, the acting must be perfect with no room for any flaw. Therefore, he has arranged it that we so act that not only do we act like real people, we become real people. There is no scope left for destroying the play. And if some of us weak actors were to discover that we are acting in this big play, we start shouting up, it's a play, it's a play. Thereby destroying the play, the beauty of the play. In a good play, if an actor comes up and says, oh, I know it's a play, he may have said the truth, but he has spoiled the play. When the object of this whole show is to set up a play for God, surely no chances could be taken, and he has taken no chances. Because he has made each one of the actors firmly convinced that this is real. The system of projection from consciousness is such that the totality of consciousness in each one of us, and there's only one of us, incidentally, that's the self, that totality of consciousness has been able to project a play which it has created so beautifully it looks real. And you are in no position to say it is unreal till you are out of the play. Therefore, you cannot do any damage to the play. Only that person can really say it's a play who is out of the play. When he's out of the play, if he were to come back on the stage, he'll still play very well. In fact, he'll play better. If a person has an awareness of the play outside the play, he'd come back and act even better because he knows the object of the play. But if a person, while acting, suddenly says, I know it's acting, he's only doing damage to the play. That is why no such risk is taken. That is why nobody really knows, however much I may talk to you and however much you may listen to me, nobody really knows it's a play till one can get off the stage and see. And getting off the stage means just picking up the level of consciousness one step higher, awaking from this larger dream. And that can be done and ought to be done through the system of meditation which we follow. Now you had asked me the question of what to do about that. And I was saying it's very simple, that since we have scattered ourselves like a storybook, like a play, into the various moving human situations that have come around us, and this is what is holding us away from waking up, the answer to how to wake up would be that you withdraw yourself from these human moving situations. That's all. If what is holding you back from going on to your real self is what holds you on to these situations, you just reverse it and bring yourself back. Now, what is holding you to these situations? That part of your consciousness which is within your control. You will notice that there is a very small part of consciousness which is within our control. We call it attention. The rest is not an alternative. I open my eyes, I see the same thing. If I don't want to see you, I still see you. The environment around me is fixed. At any stage, what I am aware of is fixed. Therefore, it is not in my control to be aware of this or that. What is in my control is to give my attention to this part of what I am aware of, or that part of what I am aware of, or not. So what is in my control? What is the part of consciousness which we can manipulate, which we can handle, which we can use, which we can utilize in attention? There's no other part of consciousness that we can use. Therefore, we start from here. We only start handling that part of consciousness which is within our control. The only part of consciousness within our control is attention. To attend to this or not. Therefore, we start from there. This attention of ours is scattered in those various human plays I referred to earlier, into the moving aspects of the story in the book. Now, we have to withdraw that. We have to withdraw our attention from all things that have held it in the world. We have to withdraw our attention from the concept that we are this body, which is also part of that same illusion. This is what holds us more than even the thoughts of the other moving part of the story, because we have become part of the story. And by we mean this body. Therefore, we have to withdraw our attention even from the body. Now, what is it that prevents us from withdrawing at will our attention from the world and from the body? There are three things. The most important obstruction to withdrawal of attention from the world and the body is the thought process. Thoughts in words. A stream of words is going in our mind all the time. And it is that stream of words that is really throwing our attention here and there. It's in words that we are involving ourselves in the story of the world. It's in words we say, now what's going on there? Now what's happening here? Now what's going to happen to me? Now what about the taxes I have to pay? What about the bones I have broken? It is in words that we reflect upon the so-called situations which have been built up by our system of projection. It's the words that's the most important obstruction to withdrawal of attention. That being so, the very first process in our meditation is somehow to handle these words adequately. If we try not to think, there are a lot of people who think meditation means to stop thinking. It doesn't work. I'd like to come across a person who says I'll stop thinking. I came across one only. When I put it to them and said, you go on thinking all the time, you never stop thinking, only one person said, I claim that I can completely stop thinking. I said, if you completely stop thinking, you will be dead. I'd like you to see you alive and stop thinking. He said, yes. So here, in front of me, he sat and he said, look, now, after this minute to this minute, I will not think at all. I said, beautiful. So he sat in front of me, and when that minute struck, so the other minute struck, he did not think. So I asked him, I said, what did you do? He said, I did not think. Did you say to yourself that you are not thinking?
That is true.
He stopped thinking at a certain wavelength, but it seemed there was a minor thin voice of his mind which was saying, that's right, now you are stopping. And which went on saying, this is right, this is exactly what you ought to have done. But it was not the voice he was normally using for thought, therefore the thought was stopping. He never realized there were so many channels operating in his mind. He thought that thought was only in one channel. When he discovered that he could stop thinking in one channel, but could not block another, we realize that there are several channels, and one of the channels is always operating, invariably, day and night, sleeping or awake, in any state of consciousness. The thought process is always operating. Therefore, if this thought process is the one that draws us out, and it is the one we have to reverse to draw ourselves in, we must do something to this thought process. How do we manage? Well, we know we can't get these words out of the mental stream, so we inject some other words, bland words. Not words that involve us in a human story, not words that involve us in a situation out of ourselves, but words that are either bland or involve us in the story of the discovery of consciousness. Words that squeeze out the other words. See, when you get something fixed up in a tube, you want to take it out, you very often have to press something else into it and squeeze the other thing out. It's the same way. in this stream is a channel of thought that keep on flowing all the time in our mind. We squeeze in bland words, which we call the repetition or simran, as part of our meditation.